My name is Aimee Arandia Østensen. I work as a professional learning facilitator in education for sustainability at Shelburne Farms in Shelburne, Vermont. I'm currently coming to you from the ancestral, unceded, and contemporary lands of the Haudenosaunee people of New York State. What is place-based education? So there is no singular definition of place-based education, and it is an evolving practice and approach. So for this session, we're going to use this definition from the Promise of Place website. Place-based education immerses students in local heritage, cultures, landscapes, opportunities, and experiences, using these as a foundation for the study of language arts, mathematics, social studies, science, and other subjects across the curriculum. Place-based education emphasizes learning through participation in service projects for the local school and/or community. So we find ourselves in an interesting situation right now where schools and teachers are needing to reinvent how we teach to meet the needs of this COVID-19 crisis. Many schools and teachers are being encouraged to use the outdoors as a site of learning in a time when we need to social distance. While this is a great solution for this crisis, it is also a great opportunity for many teachers to connect to the practices of place-based education and the benefits that go far beyond solving the challenges of social distancing and teaching through this global pandemic. This is an excerpt from Peer Associates' new publication, Schools Outdoors, Place-Based Education Responds to COVID-19 and Beyond. They also are reminding us the learning outdoors is something that has many benefits. And while it does meet the needs of the moment, it can be an enduring piece of our education system and our practices. I want to take a moment to acknowledge that outdoor learning and place-based education are related and separate practices. One can be an outdoor educator and not consider place-based education much, or one can be a place-based educator and use the outdoors in limited capacity. So as you see in this graphic, there is an overlapping space between outdoor learning and place-based education. For the purpose of this discussion, we want to expand that overlapping space and breathe some energy into that and really explore that overlapping space where outdoor and place-based education are happening simultaneously. So where does place-based education happen? This is a graphic that we use at Shelburne Farms. Place-based education happens everywhere. It begins with the individual connecting oneself to their space and their environment and their neighborhood. And as students get older, they might be exploring wider realms of place from their community out to the globe. There are unending answers to the question of where place-based education happens, but in order to do it, we need to start looking beyond the classroom and beyond the school walls to explore what connections to our curriculum and what possibilities for taking action and learning exist out in the world. At Shelburne Farms, we use this graphic to represent a process of how place-based action can take place. There is no singular process for place-based education, but we like to consider how we could begin with wonder and carry students through to action by layering inquiry with knowledge, understanding, a sense of responsibility, and caring. We hope that students develop a deep, caring relationship with the places in which they inhabit and the relationships that exist in their surroundings so that they can take informed action right now as students and in the future as adults. practices and outcomes that we hope stick with all of us. I'll briefly read. Place-based education helps students learn to take care of the world by understanding where they live and taking action in their own backyards and communities. And this comes to us from the Place-Based Education Evaluation Collaborative.
So my name is Cliff. I teach at Floodbrook School in Londonderry, Vermont. My pronouns are he, him, and his. And I'm coming to you from the heart of the occupied Abenaki territory of the Elnu Band in southern Vermont. And yeah, I'm going to just tell you a little bit about my story, outdoor ed, down here at Floodbrook School. To begin with, one of my core values is that, you know, students really need to feel ownership if they're going to have any passion for learning. And so I started our last segment of this just by saying that, like, I really like to think about the year in terms of cycles, plays really well into what we teach. And so my last metaphor was, you know, when the blackberries are starting to ripen, that's the time of the summer where I start to think about, like, what do I have to get going and what's going to happen this year in school. And, you know, now here we are a little bit further and it's apple season, the cider apples are coming, and it's kind of the time where you've started to see the things coming on the vine and the apples are going out and you're finally seeing the fruits of your labor go on. So that's kind of the metaphor of where I'm at right now. And these are some of my kids who got to see the fruits at the end of last year, just demonstrating a little bit of time out in the woods. So here at Floodbrook, we have seen a few different phases of outdoor education. To begin with, we started with some service learning in our integrated studies program. I teach social studies here at Floodbrook in the 7th and 8th grade. I've been a 6th, 7th, and 8th grade teacher, language arts, social studies, and what we call integrated studies, which is a combination of science and social studies taught through the project-based lens. My seventh graders, who I had for language arts, would start with work in the garden with our science teacher here and start doing writer's notebooks outside. And we felt, as we saw this be a really developmental approach for where our kids were at in seventh grade, that it would benefit the entire program if we really doubled down on it. So in phase two, we spent about 2 years moving out and spending our time out on the campus. We've got about 24 acres here at Floodbrook. It's about half forest and half school and open fields and pastures. And we took the Forest Friday approach and started what we call Fridays on the Land, where students are taking control of some of the stewardship of our campus, working on trail systems, working on the garden to help our farm to school program. And we also use the social studies classroom for collaborative ethnographies, and had an integrated unit in our science and social studies class where we connected with a few other schools and some of the local nonprofits here and started telling the story of the people in our place. And so the end goal is we're looking to develop a semester-based program here, either rotation through our middle schoolers or through our entire consolidated district. So that's where we've been and where we're going. Just a little bit of, you know, what we really try to spend time on. We focus a lot on character development and how kids socialize both with our class and with the community. So we do a fair amount of social emotional learning and focus on the skills there. And everything in our outdoor ed setting comes through project-based learning. Really a large focus on transferable skills. So while we have social studies and science standards that are our proficiencies we're gearing at, we have learning scales for them, we spend a lot of time talking about, you know, how this shared experience can contribute to kids' ability to clearly and effectively communicate, to problem solve, to be engaged citizens, and so on. So in our next slide, there's a little bit just about what our students have seen recently and in the last 2 years for our shared experience. So when they're out on the trails, they get to problem solve and try to figure out what can we do to improve the land for who's going to be here next, but also to be an active participant. So you've got some students here who had a tree right across our main lane of trails, and they wanted to move it. So it got bucked up. And as you can see from our pulley system here, we have it was a full advisory's worth of 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. They're using a 3-to-1 system and learning about mechanical advantage and hauling a massive sugar maple right out of the way. We not only get to use that sugar maple as a balance beam for team building at the beginning of last year's launch, but as you can see in the bottom of the slide, it actually became lumber that was milled at one of our local sawmills here for student projects. And in the next slide, you can actually see what we did just today here at Floodbrook. So we have a group of kids who are here in what we call phase one as we slowly bring kids back to school. And in the middle school, it's only 6 kids. So most of their friends are remote learning, and there's this feeling of parts of our community getting different things. And so we had our phase one learners today masked up, working on benches made out of some of the wood, both sawn locally and then also from the log that was in the prior slide. So they return to work, and they're getting to give back in addition to having a safe place if their parents are essential workers or if school is the best place for them to learn. So they're kind of getting a little bit of a taste of what the rest of our students will have when they get back here. And those are all us just working on benches with the middle schoolers today and trying to get back outside in a deliberate, intentional manner where, you know, they're doing the work that we couldn't do if we even had the time to do it these days as adults.
Mother Nature has called us into her office and she says, bring the children because I would like to speak to them directly. So I have 2 pods of middle schoolers at the Bethel Middle School, a Monday, Tuesday group and a Thursday, Friday group. Everybody else has 1 pod and does academic work remotely, and I just get kids outside. I hope you all have the experience of getting kids to see it a piece of grass differently, or look really closely and see if there's a bug there, because there's insects everywhere. We're looking at the biodiversity of life, and you can touch anything that's living and do something with it. So our goals with outdoor education, little background, I've been doing this for a few years with Bethel. Been teaching outdoor ed since, 25, 30 years now. We really want to get kids connected to themselves and to the outdoors and to as much nature as possible, and to not be afraid of it, and to look at it for their solace, And so we have a system where we've got sit spots or magic spots, so to speak, and the kids will take their journals and their pencils and go up and find the spot they want to hang out in for 5 to 15 minutes every day that we can. And they come back different, they get time to sit with themselves without the big rush and without the pressure of, social stuff going on amongst them because they are in their own spot. Then they get together and they share. We're helping with their self-esteem, and I'm also finding the leaders are coming up, every kid. Ones who are way behind the eight ball or way out in front, anyone in between, has some leadership skills that I'm finding we can help nurture them. And you watch them very closely when you teach a new skill or get connected with some kind of content area, and they'll spark. So right now, there's a ban in Bethel on fire. So it's a burn ban. And we had already started with building our fire pits. There's 5 groups and 4 groups in 2-day rotations here right now. And they go to the woods and they're developing their own campsites. And part of that, the biggest part of course, is safety. So anything that has to do with fire has to be extremely safe. We're putting over 3 inches of gravel underneath where there would be a pit and a screen over it and surrounding it with rocks or bricks. And having water on hand. And I am insisting on a screen because any one spark would be a problem. So right now we're not doing any fires because I want the children to really get that a ban is a ban. And because everything is so, so dry. You guys got rain up there. We didn't get any. We haven't had it for a long time. And so we're going to be using these metal fire pits that are off the ground on top of the gravel area when it's time. And they just said that there's no ban on small pits, on a small fire pit. So it needs to be contained, but safety's first. So you don't go out and just say, okay, everybody just go make your fires because we can now. in the middle school program, what they love is their campfires in the snow, of course. And there's on the right is a fellow who built himself a fort, though we hadn't even started shelter building yet. And let's go to the next one. Middle school, there's your safety. Up at the top there, the fire building. We're using tools, but only with the supervision of one of three of us who are trained in tool safety. The other teachers will wait until we go around. So I wanted to speak a little bit. When phase three for Vermont is just coming into existence, where kids will be in the building, I personally will be out of the building, and I'm having them send me kids and the teachers, if they will come, and go in, back into the woods and be working on our skills and our perseverance and our fortitude, you know. I'm working with biodiversity as a topic. Wonderful workshop over at the North Branch Nature Center on biodiversity, and really inspirational to just take a look at what's around you, which leads me into the negotiated curriculum that we're doing at this school, which is the kids are coming up with what they want to study in their pods. All the kids have something about animals. So when they ask each other, what do they have in common? We're going to end up finding this animal theme, which we will move into the biodiversity of nature, of course. Can we have the next slide? This is what happened last fall. We were building a trail. We work with the Maine Guide Association certification, and the program will, you'll see outlined below in another slide. Kids really were proud of building this trail, and it's used a lot now. The next slide is, here you are, your benefits. You guys can read these on your own. You don't need me to read this to you. It's pretty amazing to see what happens. And then the next slide is about the Maine Woodsman. There's a middle school and high school program, and the high school, it's based out of Maine. Anybody who's going to be a Maine guide has to pass a certification, but they're training the kids, the middle and high schoolers, intensely with very directed and thorough trainings on outdoor and how to lead trips and how to be a leader, as well as how do you do all the skills and take care of other people as well. And these are a list of some of those skills. There's some fire building and open cooking. I know I better hurry up. And the next slide after that was the map that that inner loop trail that we created last year. And there are two sections of the map. One's blown up and one's not, and they have all their compass bearings. So we're doing compass work as well. The next slide is the high school programming, which we were going to have, but we're keeping me in one school this year because of COVID. But it will be, you can look at this later. This is it, more details of how it looks. And then one more slide there for the leadership skills. You know, all the ones that you think about, those are the ones we're working for. And I wrote them down so that this, like three slides of these or four, so that you can actually think about it in terms of what you're doing with your students and how to help them become good leaders. And I'm finding this whole outdoor place-based initiative is really helping with kids developing their own leadership skills and becoming self-confident and wise and caring and a community member in a way that I don't see in the classroom. So I think that we're on the right track, and it looks like this whole school here is so happy. All the teachers are happy. The kids are happy. I worry about them going back indoors because it's, you know, they're learning, they're developing their own projects of what they want to learn and fitting everything else into that.
Like Cliff, I'm a humanities teacher, so I'll try again to be as focused as I can. And I come from a background in outdoor education and farming, and found my way into teaching. And this is really just what has worked for me at the high school level, and it's very much in progress and very much an experiment. And I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of the strengths and challenges of working with the high school age population. I don't know how many folks in our group right now are working with 9 through 12. And then also just about sort of how to really think about designing curriculum that's created with place in mind, so that it's not simply moving your English or social studies class outside, but how is place really integrated into what you're doing? Though I think, of course, getting everybody outside is amazing, no matter what that looks like. And I love those intro slides at the very beginning that Aimee and Emily used of sort of that idea of movement from wonder to action, and that's very much what has shaped my thinking. And my slides are pretty low tech, in part because I, in teaching outside, try to make it as low tech as possible. So no screens, essentially. And some of the research and film watching is done outside of our class time together. But when we're present together, we're really present. And, you know, I remember last fall being outside with students and one kid saying, well, I don't do outside. And immediately, you know, went in and dropped the class, despite the course description saying, we're going to be outside every day. And like, yes, we have those folks who are wearing flip-flops in December. But I would say for the most part, a really wide variety of personalities and backgrounds. Students have been really thrilled to be outside. I think often, particularly at the high school level, there's sort of this idea of you get off the bus or out of your car and you immediately go into the building and you're there all day. You don't really come out, and then maybe you go to sports practice, but that's pretty structured. And so this idea of play and exploration and calm outside, I think, was really novel and very much, kids are really hungry for that. And so even, you know, like sometimes it'd be like 45 and raining and we'd sit down at the, you know, in our hoop house and say, like, do people want to go for a walk? Like, what do people feel? And always people want to say, yes, like, let's go out and be in the elements. I think that one of the great things about working with high school students is that they are so independent. So I could say, you know, go do this for 35 minutes and I have a rough idea of where you are and come back. And I felt really safe and comfortable doing that with them. One of the things that I was unsure of, and I'll talk a little bit more about pace in a moment, but I wasn't sure, you know, are kids going to enjoy a sit spot where they're finding this place where they, you know, sit and connect and go there every day. And sometimes it's for 10 minutes and sometimes it's for 40. Will they think that's silly? And consistently feedback from students was, please, like, that was too short. Can we spend more time there, really getting to know this one place and interacting with it? And I think just that chance to play and slow down was so important. Did sometimes people fall asleep in their sit spots? Yes. But that also felt important too, that a lot of these kids are really busy and really scheduled, and being able to take a nap under a tree was really, you know, sort of rejuvenating for them. So another question that, you know, I've faced from both myself and from my administration, can we still do meaningful content outside? Is that possible? And I think probably everyone in this group is going to say, well, yes, of course. But I think being, you know, place-based education is this really unique opportunity to be really responsive. And I've had the benefit of having a chance to sort of plan with place in mind. And I know that many of us are in the situation of suddenly being thrust outside. But I think that designing curriculum that allows you to respond to the place that we're in on a very local level, and a more global level, to the news, to each other, to who we are as individuals. The classes that I teach are an environmental lit class with a focus on the literature of climate change, both fiction, nonfiction, and poetry, a climate justice course that really focuses on environmental racism, and then a creative writing on the trail that gets kids out and about exploring Vermont. And I think you can still do research, you can still do really, you know, thoughtful discussion. You can still, you know, use protocols to really get at some big ideas. And, you know, I think all of our targets were really connected to communication and how do you clearly communicate about things that you're passionate about? How do you understand the history of what we're talking about? And I think another great thing about high school students that I've found is that there's a real willingness to dive in, a real interest in rigorous discussion, and a desire for action. They really want to do something. And I think, you know, it's an interesting balance of sort of supporting them and taking action, and also allowing them the space to slow down and just sort of be and connect with the place around them. I think a really key thing, particularly at the high school level, is to know that a slow pace doesn't mean a lack of rigor. And we'll go to the next one. And I was really lucky that I got a chance to pilot a course this summer in the time of COVID. And I think more than ever, and this was all day outside a summer intensive, more than ever, the ability to connect, especially being outside, and, you know, being able to socially distance and take your mask off, and have some great conversations. And you can see there's a bike chariot in the middle. In there was a portable hand washing station. And I'm not giving health advice, but this is how we handled it. A portable hand washing station and some folding chairs that allowed us to be really movable. And we started off simply, like, 5-gallon bucket is great for carrying your stuff and sitting on, and it's waterproof. And so I think the final slide is next. And I think I just, the thought I want to leave you with is just that I think place-based education has, as all of you know, the power to be so transformative. This is one of my classes right before the climate strike last year. And keeping it simple and low tech, I think, is really helpful. And starting small, I had initially proposed a much bigger interdisciplinary program, and the administration was reluctant, and over time became more and more supportive and encouraging. And I think the more students were in those classes and bought in and were able to share that and talk to other students, the more enthusiasm and support we received from the administration. And I think, yeah, I'm also happy to, if anyone has other individual questions, please let me know. That was like the super quick version. So thank you. I just saw Emily's question, and I'd be happy to speak to that a little bit. And I think for us, it's been the pace of change that students and teachers maybe have been ready and excited to get outside before administrations were quite as ready to get their heads around what that might look like. And just how to figure out the logistics of that. I do think that now is a great time to kind of leap on some of the momentum of that. Though I think a challenge that comes with that is, like, how are you doing it intentionally and thoughtfully? And in one of our small breakout rooms, we were talking about sort of like, well, are we just sitting under a tent on a piece of grass? Like, what's available to us? And I think in terms of the status, what's been really satisfying, I think, seeing how rewarding it has been for students, just that they talk about the rest of their day differently. And I often teach outside first block, we have a 4-block schedule, and just sort of that introduction to their day has been, I think, so meaningful, and brings a different kind of calm and focus for the rest of their school work. So I think that's been huge. And also just seeing their willingness to really, again, and I'm coming from a high school perspective, they're wanting to make change. And whether that's like the whole class pledging to be vegetarian for a semester, or going to a protest together, or doing some writing as a form of activism, I think just that, It's been really redemptive for me as a teacher to see people, students, young people, really engaging with the world.
Bonna and Cliff, we've got a couple questions here that you might want to respond to. So one was what Annie was responding to in terms of what's been the most challenging part of pulling together your programs and what's been the most satisfying. Additionally, Perry is wondering about people's experience, if at all, with the application of outdoor learning in an urban setting. So over where she is, they have a mandate for outdoor learning this year, but in a public park. And that is an invitation to everyone beyond Bonna and Cliff as well.
So the school I was at before Floodbrook was Bellows Falls Middle School in Rockingham, Vermont. And it's, I mean, in Southern Vermont, we really don't have much that's urban. I mean, Brattleboro and Bennington are really even not, let's be honest, Burlington is incomparable to many cities in the United States. There's 26 cities that have more people than our entire state, right? But BF is kind of an interesting place when I worked there because it did have a downtown with a village and high density housing. And so we ended up doing a lot of local history pieces, and we would use little parks as launch sessions towards investigations. So we would go down to the river. We'd use like literally postage stamp parks to do mini lessons and turn it into sort of a mobile classroom. So I'm thinking of like a history scavenger hunt that we had students build a few years ago was a great place, or a great way to get kids involved in place in an area where we didn't have what we have, you know, here or at Floodbrook rather, where we have, you know, forest and streams and things. So
I was thinking that if you have a postage stamp and a plot of grass that may be 2 inches big, you get a really big lens, and just be looking for biodiversity and the kids finding what's different and bring pictures back or drawings or descriptions or all of those things of everything that they're finding. And there's a whole lot of lessons you can do with that. And a crack in the sidewalk has it, you know, especially in the insect world, you're going to find a lot of that. iNaturalist is a wonderful thing if there's a phone involved. That one uses iPhones though, but there's other apps out there also for plants, animals as well. And they will, the iNaturalist one will, you post to say you don't know what it is, what is this? And people all over the world, especially this country, will answer you what they think it is. And you're looking, it's almost like it's its own field guide. And you get, they'll help with finding what things are, even if you don't know what they are. I'm not in the city, but I've looked in a crack in the sidewalk, and we did do our biodiversity institute. We were doing a city day, and if there's a tree or a blade of grass, you can find lessons in it. You know, people look for the natural world, see what it is, and then do research with it. Just a thought.
I'd love to build on that. I've seen this thing called Rebel Botany where people were going around and like learning the names of the plants that were growing in the sidewalk and then using chalk and writing the name and putting an arrow so people that were in that space could learn what these weeds were. But I also think it's a really interesting place to think about how people in natural spaces or parks interact and what you could learn by observing about how people use these spaces. And so there might be a way, distance, to observe kind of that like human nature interaction.
I love that addition, and I was just going to add, and this may go on beyond the scope of our time here, but I spent about 20 years teaching in New York City in Manhattan, and so when it comes down to place-based education, we were so lucky to be very close to Central Park, which is a large, expansive space. However, a lot of our place-based education work wasn't in the park itself, but it was just in the neighborhood and out on the streets and getting to know all of the interdependent relationships that exist there and how they all function to help our community thrive or not.
One of my absolute favorite economics lessons for outdoor ed can happen as he's actually sometimes better in urban and mixed use environments than in our rural area. And that's to talk about production and consumption and conspicuous consumption. And so we had students a few years ago talk about I forget the term for it, but essentially it's guerrilla gardeners and the idea of, you know, people coming up with resources that are going to waste and finding places where they have a positive impact on society. So consumption and production is a really fun one to do for kids who are, you know, getting into the middle school and high school level. And I pasted the right thing I wanted to paste there, which is 3-yard safari, not the Vokaroo, which is like me talking about a food I ate from my advisory. So apologies for the first paste. Feel free to listen.
I was writing it down. That's funny. Okay, there were some questions about challenges and satisfaction in creating programs. The satisfaction is an easy one where the teachers are really biting into it now, whereas it was just a couple of us taking people out. And you know, the one program where teachers, the elementary teachers, were supposed to go out and be part of it and bring what we're doing outside back into the classroom and vice versa. And most of the teachers are interested and would participate, and a couple would not. And that's just the way it goes, I would imagine, anywhere. On the other hand, getting the middle school teachers out has just opened up a whole new world to them, realizing that we're going to be outside anyway. They can be out in the woods and actually do activities and do their work out there and do their explorations. So that's very satisfying for me to see that there's so much enthusiasm. I think the challenge is to have enough energy to keep up with the kids. They are like mountain goats.
Does anyone else have questions, things that you're like really hoping to figure out before the kids come back on Tuesday, or anything you're grappling with specifically?
One thing we talked about in one of our breakout sessions was just this idea of like starting small and like giving yourself permission, like especially if, I mean, even those of us who are very outdoorsy people but have never done deliberate instruction in the outdoors, like you don't have to master it the first time. So that metaphor of the blackberries that comes back to me is like you want to pick everything that's in your reach, and like don't worry about it after that. You'll start small and you'll get much better. And the biggest challenge for me, I know, is countering the message that we're just playing, because there's nothing wrong with playing. It's learning. That's how humans learn for so long. You know, we come into the world as this amazing learning machine, and we lose the joy in it at some point. But it's not always playing. There's a lot of great education. And, you know, I even had a colleague say to me, you know, I didn't get into this to be a teacher. To be a summer camp counselor. I got into this to be a teacher. And it's like, well, you know, your kids are going through some really tough stuff right now. So there are skills of summer camp counselors that you need to have if you're going to be a successful, healthy adult role model in their life, whether you want to teach at a summer camp or not.
Thanks, Cliff. We have a wonderful closing question from Audrey. But before we do that, Rachel Mann, sorry about the pronunciation, has posted this wonder, and I might need your clarification on this, so please help. I'm wondering about how to teach a curriculum outside while also doing legitimate outdoor education, not just taking my indoor teaching outside. And I'm glad you surfaced that parentheses, because there is space this year for doing things like taking your quiet reading time outside, and that's what you would have been doing indoor, but you're doing it outdoor. And there is space for having your morning meeting or community meeting in a circle outside rather than inside. And I think your question is more about translating some of what you would have done to better leverage the being outdoors. But would you clarify that before folks respond?
A lot of it has been about using place as a way to build connection. And I think that does translate to all ages, and building content around that connection. So again, my focus tends to be climate change and climate justice and environmental racism, and thinking about how to recognize, how to have students recognize their own relationship to place and then build from there to sort of broaden their perspectives. I keep coming back to the slides that Aimee and Emily shared at the very beginning. And I think that could certainly be, you know, related to first graders too. And I think also having time to try things out. And I think one really amazing thing about teaching high school is that I feel like I'm able to have a lot of those conversations with kids in the moment of the way that Aimee and Emily have been like, well, to be a transparent facilitator, I feel like I'm really able to say that with students and say, did that work? Like, did that feel like the connection worked? Did it not? Where should we go tomorrow? We started talking about this thing. Should we keep going? And I think just trying to be really responsive.
I think that especially the younger children need time to have some control over what they're learning, because we feed them all the time. We're feeding them information and ways of learning, but to give them the space to ask questions and follow their hearts, follow what they're curious in about, and do your research from that. In fact, the whole group can do research on what one of the kids is curious about, or you can break into groups or whatever. But to be able to expand their consciousness into the outdoors instead of into the book, and then use the books as a supplement to enrich their outdoor learning. And I think that goes for all ages. I think the high school work that Annie's talking about and sustainability, all of those, even racial justice, everything, can be filtered through the outdoors, and it could be a way of expanding those topics.
I'd like to ask our three presenters if you can concisely respond to this prompt. If you could give one piece of advice to other educators just starting on this adventure of outdoor learning and place-based ed, what would that be? Try to keep it concise. That's my challenge to you.
Know that you're supported. Reach out when you want help and networking, and just do it. Let your heart guide you. Is that concise enough?
I feel like Bonna kind of said it all, but I would also just say to slow down, like just be able to be present with your students, with the place.
And I would just remind students that, you know, this is what they were made for. You know, being outside is something humans have always interacted with and dealt with, and they can do it, and it's going to be tough at times, but they're built for it, and they're going to grow.
And listen on with all your senses, and encourage the kids to do that.
I want to warmly thank our presenters, Annie, Bonna, and Cliff. I want to thank all of you for coming. I want to share my number one tip, which I learned from my third and fourth graders the day I first took them outside to do outdoor learning. And that is that if you've only ever gone outside at school for recess, there's a whole new set of skills that you need to learn to be a learner outside. And that will happen when you listen and slow down and all of that, but that is definitely a curve, and it took us a couple weeks of practicing like sit spots and things like that to really be able to be in a different mode than that kind of wild, gleeful running around that often happens too.
I would just like to say that I am so hopeful that you all have joined us here today for this exciting adventure and incredibly challenging moment. And that we, Emily and I, and Bonna, Cliff, and Annie, even though we're ending this webinar today, we are available to you if you want to reach out to us and continue the conversation, share resources, and just be part of this developing, evolving practice.
Thank you.